enables to follow the temperature dependent of the lattice parameters, A, B, C. They don't show any singularity at the transition, of the ordering transition. But the angle beta, which is the monoclinic distortion angle, does show an anomaly, a change of slope, which means that there is a magnetostriction of the AC plane. And this, whilst in the second transition, nothing happens really. And this enables to guess that the monoclinic symmetry is broken, the center of symmetry is broken because of the appearance of ferroelectricity. And since the magnetostriction is in the AC plane, we can guess that what is lost is the twofold rotation axis of the AC plane, and just the mirror plane remains as a symmetry axis, as a symmetry operation. Just for comparison, recently other evidence of, it's called JANT, but let's say large ferroelectricity, there is a kind of, I don't know then a giant how it could be called. But this is three, they obtain about 0.3, which is about the same value, but this is obtained in single crystals at saturation, while we expect at least 1 microcoulomb or even maybe 10. And in this case, it's not easy to understand the coupling between ferroelectricity and magnetism, because the magnetic structure is formed by three irreducible representations. So it's a complex helix-type magnetic structure, and also there is a charge ordering. So in this case, which is interesting, it's difficult to guess which is the mechanism underlying the improper ferroelectricity. In this case, we have a picture of exchange friction driven by magnetoelastic coupling. So we recall the expression for the cross-coupling between strain magnetic field and ferroelectric order parameter. We have this collinear C-type magnetic structure evidenced by neutrons corresponding to these values of the spins at neighboring sites, going from this to this and going from this to this, R, R plus A, R, R plus B. And with a little calculation, you end up to realize that the dominant mechanism is indeed the exchange friction, so where polarization is proportional to the scalar product of two neighboring ions, moments. Which are the possible reasons for a large polarization? As I said, the large bucking angle should enhance the next nearest neighbor interaction. So the magnetic friction is probably enhanced by, is a guess, by this angle. And also, since oxygens screen weakly the dipolar field, because oxygen cannot move, the polarization remains unscreened and therefore is larger. So to conclude, I hope I convinced you that this is an interesting system for studying the spin electron coupling, in the spin lattice coupling in transition metal oxides. These are high pressure phases. This compound with lanthanum is a new improper ferroelectricity with large spin induced polarization, which is of the order of 1 microcoulomb centimeter squared. We have indication that this polarization is induced by an exchange friction driven by the C type of structure. And this is due to probably magnetoelastic coupling, and the large polarization is possibly to the large tilt of the bonds, the weak screening due to the symmetry limited distortion of the oxygen. And therefore, it would be interesting to investigate further on single crystals the property of this system. Thank you for your attention. The exchange friction in the literature, it's what I just showed at the beginning, that if you have, it should be called inverse magnetic friction. If you take in a crystal a given magnetic interaction of two magnetic ions, okay, the distance between the two ions depends upon the sign of the magnetic interaction, of the magnetic exchange, of the exchange interaction. So there is the whole literature which show basically this is the super exchange. You have a given, let's say, you have a given exchange interaction, which can be either antiferromagnetic or ferromagnetic, and these will change by changing the sign of the exchange interaction. A change of the magnetic structure, or vice versa. You change the magnetic structure by inducing, for example, an external magnetic field. You turn, for example, the magnetic moments, or you have a low high spin transition, and you change the strength of the exchange interaction, and you modify the distance between the two ions. So I just showed the
in the circuit have a phase change, magnetic phase change, or not?
I should put it in this way. You have a given strength and sign of the exchange interaction in a given crystal. And this depends upon the magnitude of the moments, and depends upon, as I just showed you, for example, the relative orientation of the orbitals. This is the super exchange theory, so either you have a perpendicular or parallel orbitals, you have ferromagnetic or antiferromagnetic coupling. So the feeling, this is quite subtle. The distortion of the lattice structure induced a given orbital polarization, which affects the sign of the magnetic exchange interaction. And this, in turn, renormalize the distance between the neighboring ions. So there is a really an interplay between the lattice distortion and the charge, because of the occupancy of the orbitals, orbital ordering, and spin ordering. And therefore, of course, then the question is whether the restriction can break this, the center of symmetry of the structure by inducing a spontaneous polarization or not. So for example, I didn't discuss this, but the C structure alone cannot break the symmetry. So probably this structure is not exactly C. It must have a component, for example, a canted component, which can account for the symmetry breaking.
Yes. So you showed us that the VRL is a giant thing.
Yeah, because
question is giant. So what do you need to publish another VRL?
Yeah.
Whatever.
Well, I don't know if taking the Roddy's colossal, how to say, how colossal. I don't know, yeah, probably it was a giant, because if I remember, the statue was about 12 meters high, so I would call it a giant. No, okay, beside the joke, it's true that, as everyone knows, to publish in some journals, you need to exaggerate. They call giant because they gained, I don't want, but until now, you had basically 0.04, okay, anyway, 0.04 microcoulomb per centimeter square. They gained a factor of 5, and they justified the term giant with this factor of 5. I mean, now it's subjective, as you know, but in my opinion, one should say the following.
You realize I didn't make my question. You're explaining a lot, but I didn't make my question. What is your number?
My number is at the moment is 0.4, late public 0.25. But we didn't reach saturation. They reached saturation. And also they measure on single crystals. And In single crystals, polarization is expected to be 10 times larger than in polycrystals. So we measure 0.4, not at saturation, in polycrystals. So we can be, we can guess that at least we should gain a factor of, to be very conservative, 3-4.
And while we are talking here, maybe the sample, the good sample that will come also
right here. Who is me?
Yeah.
Yeah, as I said.
Someone back in Paris or?
I don't know, we have already the samples. The samples are ready.
Crystals.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So these are preliminary data, I mean, I just showed you, but you know, it's not easy to measure single crystals because they are small. So it's a challenge, but we hope to do it very soon. So hopefully in a few months, I can tell you we have larger polarization than 1 microcoulomb, and then we may choose the adjective we should be larger than giant. Anyway, no, I think giant is a misnomer. Is a just large improper ferroelectricity. So in a proper ferroelectrics, you have about, which are used in usual applications, you have 50, 60 microcoulomb per square centimeters. In improper ferroelectrics, you have 1,000 times less. Now you have 100 times less, and they call it giant, because it's improper, not proper. But in my opinion, it should be just, you should just give the number, and the number is with no discussion. So for applications, you should have of the order of 1 to 10 microcoulomb per centimeter square, because otherwise the ferroelectric domain, it would not be stable, thermally not stable. So you need a, otherwise, it would be like a super paramagnetic behavior, right? You have a weak polarization which can be thermally activated, and that would not guarantee a stable polarization.
But still, this polarization is just after the.
Yes, so the point is now, okay, there are several steps. Of course, a device should work at room temperature. But you know,
yeah, sure.
Laser gallium arsenide laser years ago was working only at liquid nitrogen temperature. Now they work at room temperature. I mean, that's the usual trend is to just step by step. So first thing is to have large polarization, and then see how to increase the ordering temperature. So that's why this system is interesting, because you have next nearest neighbor interaction because of the shorter distance between the next nearest neighbors. So you should have maybe a true strain of chemical substitution, an even stronger exchange interaction, and that would hopefully raise the temperature. But okay, that's first of all, I mean, fundamental studies, not yet application driven. So,
are there
films? Very good question. We would like to make them. And indeed, with strain, that would be an important control parameter for tailoring the properties. That's a very good perspective.